Perfect. So thank you so much for joining us today. This presentation is one of several presentations that are being offered as part of Open Education Week. We invite you to attend the other presentation to this week, and you can see the link in our library news blog with links to the other presentations in the chat as well. This presentation is being recorded and will be posted to the ISU Library's YouTube channel for future viewing. Following a 20-minute presentation, we'll have a question and answer period where you can unmute yourself and ask a question, or if you'd like to post a question in the chat, I can read your questions during the question and answer portion of the presentation. Our presenter can respond to those questions at that time as well. So with us today, we have Dr. John Curry. Dr. Curry is a professor and chair of the Organizational Learning and Performance Department at Idaho State University. He's also recently been named Editor-in-Chief of Tech Trends, one of the top journals in his field of instructional design and technology. In addition, he is the co-editor of the book, The Greatest Lecture I Was Never Taught, Leadership Lessons and Mentoring Moments in the Lives of Everyday Educators. And while he has won multiple awards for both his teaching and research, Dr. Curry has devoted his career to professional service. At the department, college, and university levels, he has served on numerous committees in many different roles. Here at Idaho State University, he has served on the University LMS Committee, OER Committee, the Teaching Innovation Grant Committee, a policy working group, and multiple subcommittees. Within his professional organization, AECT, that is the Association for Educational Communications and Technology, he served on the board of directors for two terms, the executive committee, and in the division leadership for both the Division of Emerging Learning Technologies and Technology Integrated Learning Division. Within that organization, he has also fulfilled numerous committee assignments and served on the Leadership Development Committee for over a decade. In addition, he was the conference planner for both the 2019 and 2022 AECT International Conventions, and he is again serving as a conference planner for the upcoming 2025 International Convention. Each year, in recognition of Dr. Curry's career of service to his field and the organization, the AECT Division of Emerging Learning Technologies gives out the John Curry Distinguished Service Award. He has also been the recipient of Presidential Service Awards from four different AECT presidents. In 2023, Dr. Curry was recognized with the AECT Distinguished Service Award for Extraordinary Contributions to the ECT, the Educational Communications and Technology field. This award is the highest given by AECT and honors contributions and accomplishments impacting the field of educational communications and technology and related fields. The award recognizes exemplars from innovation, creative development, outstanding leadership, scholarly works, and professional practice at career milestones or during a lifetime of achievement, including activity in AECT, as well as other organizations and communities. However, if asked, he will tell you his greatest professional achievement is the contributions his students make to the field of education technology. So thank you so much for being with us today, Dr. Curry, and we look forward to your presentation.
Thank you. Gosh, that just sounds ridiculous hearing it back. You know, I hear all of that and I'm just a kid from Oklahoma. You know, I grew up in Mustang, Oklahoma, and if you'd told me someday that anybody would care about what I had to say, I would have not believed you. I appreciate the opportunity to present here at Open Ed Week. And really, what I'm just going to talk about is my experience that I had in one of my classes trying to develop an OER text. Initially, when I applied for the stipend, my plan was to do it in one particular class, but my schedule kind of fell through and I ended up not teaching that class. But I had another class. Initially, it was going to be a master's level introduction to instructional design course. But then I ended up not teaching that. So I was teaching a doctoral level learning theories course. And so I did the project in that course. just my background kind of in OER. I have been a proponent of open resources in my classes for well over a decade, probably 15 years or so. And, you know, I kicked the idea around there beforehand, whether or not I should do it. David Wiley is a good friend of mine. And so we'd had multiple conversations over the years. And finally, for me, it boiled down to something that David said to me once. And he said, how can you charge people for knowledge? And I was just kind of like, oh, I don't have an argument for that. And so that's what led me to ditch all textbooks and decide that I was going to make the effort to write the content that I needed or find the content that I could use rather than ask my students to pay for a textbook that I would, you know, maybe use half the chapters or three fourths of the chapters. But I mean, any of us who've ever had to pick a textbook, there's never all the chapters, you know. And so that has kind of been just my standard operating procedure for the last, like I said, I don't know, 10, 15 years. That's probably more like 15 years. I just think that it's, if I can spend a little bit extra time on my part, on behalf of my students to save them some money, then I'm going to do that. I remember going to college again, as I said, kid from little town, Mustang, Oklahoma, showing up fall of 1987. I'm dating myself now. Fall of 1987, showing up to BYU as a freshman. I didn't, you know, I'd just gone to high school. And even though my grandfather was a university professor, I didn't know how college classes ran. I didn't know. I mean, my teachers had always given me my books. I didn't know you went and bought books. I had no earthly idea what that was. I remember walking with my roommate and we had to go up to the BYU bookstore and buy our textbooks. And, I, you know, it was like a whole floor of the bookstore was all just textbooks. And I, you know, number one, figure out how to navigate that, but then waiting in the line. And then I remember writing that check to pay for my books and thinking, I don't want any of these books. These are terrible. And it being such a, you know, there was sticker shock. But just then, you know, just this, like, am I really going to read all of this stuff? I mean, it was not good. Now, I probably would have done better that semester had I actually gone to class. I'm just going to throw that out there. I was not the world's best student as a freshman. But that experience stuck with me. And then I was an English major on top of that. And so when I got back from my LDS mission, and as an English major, being handed stacks and stacks of textbooks, or not handed, buying stacks and stacks of textbooks, big, thick anthologies of literature that, again, we read 20 things out of, but I had to pay $150 to read, you know, seven poems and three essays. It was really, I just thought, gosh, this is a dadgum racket. And then going to grad school, my master's degree, I got the English degree. Well, my master's degree was in the theory and practice of writing. And again, just a whole bunch more books that I didn't read. And I started as an undergrad keeping my English texts because I thought I was going to be an English professor. That's what I thought I was going into. And so I was building up my library. Most of which I still have those books, but then I switched fields after my master's degree for my doctorate and to instructional design. And all of a sudden I needed all new books and they're not cheap. And so those experiences as a student stuck with me. And it's always made me really conscious of my responsibility to my students. And, you know, money was tight for me. I was young married. Then I was young married with kids. And so that was a big deal to me. You know, if I had to pay for this book, we better use it, dadgummit. So all this to say, I've tried a lot of different things in my courses. I've written a lot of content, some of it good, some of it not good. I've tried to find open materials, some of which is good, some of which is not. But as I've gotten to this point in my career, I work mainly with doctoral students. And one of my focuses, I don't know what it is. One of the things I focus on, how's that? One of the things I focus on is trying to help them be part of the academic conversation. My major professor taught us that. It doesn't matter if you're right or you're wrong, but participate. And so one of the ways I do that is I really try to work with them to publish before they get out, to present. And so I'm always looking for ways to do that with them. So all of this is to say, we've been going through some programmatic changes in instructional design and technology. And as part of that, we needed some new courses. And as part of that process, it came time to teach this first course, this new one, this learning theories course. I've taught learning theory before, and I had all of my old learning theory texts on the shelf. Three different ones I have on my shelf. Two of which are out of print. You know, you can't even get them anymore. And so I started thinking about what's the best way that I can cover this content with my students, but also give them an experience beyond just sitting here. And this week we're going to talk about Piaget, and next week we'll talk about Bruner, and then we'll get to, you know, information processing, and, you know, all, you know, that's just boring. I hated sitting through that as a student. So it's even worse when you have to teach it. So I always look for innovative ways to approach content. So I had written, I had applied for the stipend to do a text, an introductory instructional design text for the master's level course. And like I said, I wasn't teaching it. So I decided to take that time that I'd already dedicated and committed by nature of taking the stipend that I'd committed to and use it in this course. And so some of it worked well and some of it didn't. So the way I had designed the course was to basically go through each of these theories, but to have each of my students, again, these are graduate students, most of them doctoral students, and have each of them write a chapter of the text. That is a fantastic idea. And it didn't work at all. I'm just going to be honest with you, because I wasn't prepared for what my students' needs would be. What I mean by that is I had my students, I planned out the chapters. I planned out everything that I wanted to cover. I worked with them to select content that they, even if they didn't know it, they felt like they were going to be comfortable covering. I had them teach that week, right? And then they were, a draft of the chapter was due at the middle of the semester, the final chapter at the end of the semester. What I didn't anticipate, and it was good. They did a good job with the developing their online modules. I have a pretty solid template for my courses. They all just followed my template. They all got good content. That part of the idea worked really well. What didn't work well, what I hadn't anticipated, was the wide range. And I know these students. I you know, in a small grad program, you get to know your students really well. The wide range of writing ability at that level, I was not prepared for. And I've taught writing at the graduate level for 20 years. But for some reason, this class, it was crazy how different they were. Some of the stuff that I got was really solid, really well put together, really well. The flow made sense. and others, it was honestly like they had never written anything of this type, anything academic in their lives. So that was my first challenge. Some of them were able to just jump in and start writing right away, weren't afraid of it. And others, even though they were given their topic, just didn't even know where to begin. Even though that they had come up with great content for a week, they had no earthly idea how to put a chapter together. I mean, they read chapters, but to put them in front, they just had no earthly idea. So I was not prepared for that. And then we were dealt a little bit of a maybe a blow to our egos and imposter syndrome when we went to the AECT conference this last year. And we were meeting, my students and I were meeting with Rick West, who's a professor at BYU in our field, and who has a lot of texts on EdTech Books, Royce Kimmon's platform. And Rick was meeting with my students and talking about publishing. And he just happened to mention, and my students use his texts, you know, whenever we can. And he just happened to mention, oh, so-and-so, another big author in the field, so-and-so and I are putting together our next project is a learning theories text. And I kind of looked at my students and they were all like, oh, no. Oh, no, we're not going to put this out if they're putting something out. Then the imposter syndrome set in huge, even for me, I was like, oh man, do I want to do this knowing the disparity in the writing that I'm getting? Do I want to do this and subject not so much me because I don't care, but I wanted this experience to be really positive for them. And so I talked to most of them and I said, you know, what do you think we should do with this? You know, how do you feel about this? And it was pretty unanimous. Please don't put that out there knowing that they're going to come with another book behind. And I could understand that. And so we talked about it at length because I had most of this class was there at the conference with me. And ultimately it decided not to publish it out. Now, given all of that, I think a lot of that was process. If I'd had a better process, I think it would have been better. And I think they would have felt more confident. And last week I was at the Teaching for Learning conference and was in a presentation. And I was actually sitting in a group with Royce Kimmons. And we were in a presentation where the group from BYU Idaho was showing their process for putting together OER texts. And they put out about 20 OER textbooks a year at BYU Idaho. And so we sat through their process and participated in the process. And literally in the hour that we were in that presentation, they had just gotten a project like a week or two before. And in an hour in that presentation, them showing us their process, we put together like nine chapters of a book, a draft, nine chapter draft, following their process. And so had I known then with my students what I know now from that conference, I think it would have been a much better experience. And in a nutshell, they have a template that they follow, but then they went out, they just had us they assigned us all chapters. And then they had us go search for existing OER materials. And then for the draft, then they had a place for the content for the chapter. And they just, everything that was licensed to be able to do it, we just copied and pasted all the text and threw it in. And so all of a sudden there's a draft that you now start going and cleaning up. If I'd have had that when I worked with my students, I think we would have had a completely different experience. So that's my next project. I teach this next fall. I'm teaching a program evaluation course. And we're going to do a book and we're going to follow that process. And I'm interested to see One, if they're more confident in what they put together. Two, if it helps with the disparity in writing. And three, how I feel about it, just in the sense of, all right, we've got all this content. Let's go ahead and let's throw it up on EdTech Books, because I know they don't have a book on it. So let's go throw it up on EdTech Books and see what happens. So that's my experience. How did I do?
Amazing. I had all these questions and you answered all of them during this presentation. I was like, what's the biggest hurdle? You talked about that. What's your step going forward, right? What can be done? So it was really interesting. I do have a follow-up question, if unless Laura does as well, about...
We've got like five, so you go first.
Okay. My follow-up question is, how do you think, or does the proliferation of like ChatGPT and AI influence or have a, you know, an effect on your, you know, OER textbook or the proliferation of all these things? Does it impact you?
So here's my very unpopular opinion about generative AI. This past fall was the first time that I put a generative AI statement in my syllabus. And I said, I don't care if you use it, because you're responsible for whether or not it's right.
Right.
I don't even, and depending on the assignment, I don't even care if it's cited. I use it all the time. I mean, I use it to help write letters of recommendation. When I had to write my own annual review for this year, I threw in the prompt that I had to answer. I threw in the sections from my vita and I said, write me a summary. And so I use it. And so I'm kind of, on stuff like that, I tend to be an early adopter. I could care less if they use it to help come up with a draft, because it ultimately it has to be right. I'm not afraid of AI. AI has, my daughter, I've got a daughter who's a freshman in high school, made the comment to me yesterday, something about this new AI stuff. And I'm like, what are you talking about, this new AI? AI is not new. Back in the day when I was in grad school, Microsoft Word, you remember that dumb little paperclip, Clippy? I mean, that's all AI. And when it gives you the misspell, and that's so it doesn't freak me out. So Iris, to get to your question, it doesn't bother me, right? It just doesn't, because as a writing teacher, I look at it as a draft. It's kind of like that movie Finding Forrester, when Sean Connery gives the kid the essay he wrote and said, use this as a start and then go from there. So yeah, it doesn't bother me. It doesn't bother me. It helps me write faster. And so, yeah, I don't care if my students use it. There you go. Laura, what do you got for me?
Oh, I was going to say, I in my class, I'm teaching generative AI, the good, bad, and the ugly. So we're talking about ethical uses of AI in class all the time and how to cite it, and so that they're not afraid of it. But the number one thing is communicating with their professors at all times.
I have some good articles for you.
Really?
Because in Tech Trends, my January issue, I was actually the guest editor. That's before I became the editor-in-chief. We have one article on ethics and AI.
Yeah.
One by Ted Frick called Are We Dupes? I'll send you some links.
I'm working on an article right now, so I would love that, because I attend weekly seminars on this and I talk about it with my class all the time and I love it. Okay. Yeah. Question. Oh, and by the way, I use AI to create my outlines all the time. Okay. I was considering, because I am teaching my 3-credit course this summer, all open access materials, including APA, because APA has done a wonderful job on their website of giving us everything with reference examples that you can point to. And I've been able to create it in a way that I encourage them to buy the APA manual, because most of the students that take this class are pre-nursing majors. Mm-hmm. But some of the students are taking it are high school students. And so there's that disparity of, and I don't see them in person. This is all asynchronous and they have 8 weeks. So I can't afford for them, as me as an instructor, and for them as students, to even go half a week without the text. So mm-hmm. I've opted, they don't have to buy anything. We're going to do it all online. And I've thought about, I mean, and there's a book I really, really like, and I found some other OER texts, but I've thought about creating an OER textbook kind of from scratch, but bringing in other materials, but starting it as a module base. Mm-hmm. Like I have a module for this and I have a module for this, and then compiling them, but creating them as modules so that I can put them into my LMS.
Mm-hmm.
What did you use? This is a two-part question. What did you use to draft your OER on? And did you just use a Google Doc, or did you, you know, where you could have the interactive?
So I just had them. I didn't care if they did it in Google Docs or in Word. I just had them doing a word processor first and turn it into me that way so I could give them commentary and stuff on it. Then they just turned in a Word document at the end.
Okay. Because I rely a lot on videos and a lot of auditory. I'm trying to hit all the different types of learning. And then because I have yet to play around with Pressbooks, is it possible to draft in Pressbooks?
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then, you know, before you publish, so you can play around with the modules and
do those. Super easy. Super easy. Yeah.
And do you have experience with the platform that was discussed yesterday from the speaker from BYU?
EdTech Books? Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Which do you prefer?
They, at the base level, at the creation level, they're fairly similar. Where they differ greatly is the back end and the end user experience. So on the back end, what's really cool is like I wrote one of the chapters that's on Pressbooks, and it's kind of about this foundational theorist in our field. And so a lot of people use that in their classes, right? Because it's the chapter written on it. But I can go in as the author of that chapter. I've got analytics where I can go in and see accesses. Mm-hmm. I can see, you know, specific ratings on it. So I can really get a lot. I mean, I don't know how many articles I've published or book chapters I've published off the top of my head, but that's the only one I can go tell you exactly how many people have been there.
Okay. You know?
So okay. I like that. Mm-hmm. I like that. I also like the fact that I can go in and edit it still. If something else comes up where I get a better example.
Okay, so it's dynamic.
And then it's updated for everybody, yeah. But on the end user experience, the advantage that the Pressbook, or not, excuse me, the EdTech Books platform has, like Royce was saying, is it's optimized so they can get it in so many different formats. You know, mm-hmm. If you do Pressbooks,
mm-hmm.
it's not going to be set up to be able to be used on the phone. You know, it's not set up that way to download it and print it the same ways, all those different options. EdTech Books is set up that way. Royce has designed it that way.
Okay.
But Pressbooks isn't. So it's a more robust system. But not everybody needs that robust of a system. If you want it, it's there. And like he said, they've got books on all sorts of topics that are not just EdTech books, right? But the interesting thing I think about it is the fact that the way it's set up, and he talked about this yesterday, is, you know, all three of us are on the OER committee, you know. It would be interesting to see if ISU would want their own instance for open textbooks.
Yes.
And we could just start doing our own and have all of that optimization there. And I think that would show a commitment.
Yeah.
Just wanting to do it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that was one of the things that I took away. Having heard that speech from Royce twice in the last week, I was just like, why aren't we doing something?
Why aren't we doing that?
And but it's probably because we have Pressbooks, you know, mm-hmm. but I think it's more robust.
But we can have more than one, right?
Yeah, because you could just link to the other one. Yeah, you can.
I was going to say, in the interest of time, though, I know you have
okay.
to get going.
It's keeping me out of a meeting. It's okay. Let's keep going.
Well, thank you so much for being here. It was really interesting. very engaging, and I learned a lot. So I'm excited to see what this goes.
Thank you. I look forward to those emails.
I'll get you some. I will. And I've got a bunch in my editor queue right now that are all on AI. So I know there's a bunch coming out in our folder.
Awesome. Okay.
Well, thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you all. Appreciate you.